gets a scholarship and has some fun like you do, I think a hall full of people and people without the hall will benefit. Thank you for that, Sheshadri. There's this computer science graduate, R.A. Sudha, who started drawing and sketching from when she was 14 years old. And this is actually her hobby and passion. She has a photography salon in about birds in Hyderabad. She has two children studying in America. She inspired her husband to take up birding, and now he's an avid birder. And she has a few paintings which are being exhibited in the corridor. So I request all of you to take a look at them when you step out. And it's not coffee time yet. So our next speaker is from Kerala. And he's been a Bangalorean for the last 15 years. He's keenly interested in bird distribution and is known for publishing a lot of checklists from across South India. He is coordinator for Bird Count India and has been associated with eBird for some time. He is also one of the associate editors of a journal called Indian Birds. In January this year, when we had this Karnataka Bird Festival in Hampi, he presented behind the scenes, that is what went into the making and publishing of the updated checklist of birds of Karnataka. For someone to do all this and more, being a hobbyist bird watcher is something simply amazing. Today we'll speak about Kerala Bird Atlas, which is a citizen science project that maps the distribution and abundance of birds across the entire state of Kerala. It's the first of its kind in our country, and it's a model that should inspire several such projects. It began in 2015 and it's expected to run till 2020. To unfold the Kerala Bird Atlas for all of us, here is Praveen.
Thank you, Ullas and Kuru, for inviting me here. So this is a project which is kind of midway into it. The show has been run from Kerala. I do participate, so I'm here as a representative of the birders in Kerala, sharing their experiences and results with you. So, there are quite a few people, so if you haven't been there yet, there are a lot of fantastic birds to see. So, it's full of endemics, forest as well as our villages. So, the bird you see here, this one, this is the Banasara elephant, the Banasara chilopan. It's a new genus which has been recently described from Western birds, the chilopan, and that's the rarest of those chilopans, and most of the birds are found in Kerala. This bird is a shorthorn, which used to be called as a shortwing or a blue robin. Again, a new genus for Western birds. Most of the birds you would see in Kerala. So, if you haven't visited yet, or if you have visited once, you should visit it again. There's still a lot of good birds to see in Kerala. Next, please. Few facts about Kerala, which some of them you may know, some of them may be new for you. Internet and mobile penetration, quite good, probably the best in the country. So most of the people see. Education and print media has been traditionally good in Kerala. So it's kind of easy to reach children, and it's also too easy to reach people. So that helps in certain aspects. Next one, please. The first bird book in Malayalam was published in 1958. This is done by Professor K.K. Nilavendran. He used to be writing quite a lot in the dailies also. And it has gone to the fifth edition now. 2017, fifth edition came out. That has helped a lot in nurturing the community out there for birding. And most birders either directly or indirectly relate to the person or the group. I'm not sure how many of you know this. This is the Kerala State Youth Festival. It is supposed to be the largest youth festival in Asia. Extremely competitive event, a lot of enthusiasm, a lot of people participate in it. If you are in Kerala when this happens, you must go and look. It's really a fun event with a lot of energy. This is from Munar. I won't explain what this is. People are queuing in front of a shop to buy some liquid. We call it shop. But the point is, next slide please, it's always celebration. You just need to find some excuse to celebrate. So, I think we have probably the largest number of festivals in India. usual. It's mostly some excuse to go and celebrate and have something. So, now about Baratas. So what is a Baratas? An atlas is a book with a lot of maps which shows cities, countries, and roads and things like that. A Baratas is a book which shows where the birds are. And when you have to explain the birds, you will also have to say when it will be found. So there is some amount of seasonality in the atlas. And you may also have some amount of abundance value, besides that, how common it is, how rare it is. So that's more what the bird atlas is all about. And these are some of the bird atlases which has happened not in Asia, but mostly from the western countries. There are quite a few features now. But the history, in 1962, they have the first bird atlas. So in 1958, we have the first bird book in Kerala. In 1962, already the first bird atlas process is in. And in 1970, the first breeding atlas is also out. And by 2008, there has been quite a number of bird atlases from Australia to South Africa to a lot of countries in the West. And amazingly, there's a study which showed that 27.9 million bird records have been collected only from these bird atlas projects. That's huge. Still look at the eBird is going ahead in India this year. After 5 years, they are 7 million. So this is, some of them are pre-internet era, so they are pen and paper issues. So this is a huge number that has been collected out of bird atlas. Next, please. So why make a bird atlas? So it looks like you have a lot of work, so why would you do it? One reason is that birds are already being monitored, people are already going out, they are already looking for birds. Let's see if we can do something more systematic. The more interesting thing is that we have to understand the fine scale distribution. So we have the field days, most of you would be having field days, where there are some paint sketches of where you can see the birds. But this is something more to actually understand exactly where the birds are and how common it is in different places. And of course, to better understand other species, so only when you know where it occurs, you know what are its threats or what, how it's doing. So that's another way. So that's the map from one of these birds. Next, please. And for conservation planning, so that's probably the most important thing which why people are already doing birds in elsewhere. So assessing the changes in distribution of habitats, this thing really, really important. We do a bird atlas now and we do a bird atlas 20 years later and you see the difference. So you actually would know that some birds are becoming more common or they become rare. So that delta change to find out what has changed in the last 10 years, this one great thing to find out. And that reflects on the biodiversity also. So this is like an indicator to the biodiversity and you know what has changed. And assessing the importance of urban and green spaces. So that's another aspect of bird atlas. Typically bird atlas tend to be spatially spread. In the sense, you don't look at good habitats only, you look at all kinds of habitats. And then you probably realize that some parts of the town, for example, Kabul Park, is actually harboring a lot of bird diversity, and that comes out in numerical numbers, saying that this is the contribution of Kabul Park in terms of biodiversity impact. So that kind of information comes out statistically and numerically out of bird diversity. And obviously, identifying key sites for conservation, so that's an after effect of it. And predicting impacts of human activities and local species distribution. This is another important aspect which comes out of it, because you have the entire region mapped systematically and you also know how those different areas are. So you have two different areas. One area is rich, diverse, with a lot of habitats. Another area is more an urban landscape, and you have the bird data from both places. Now if this bad habitat gets replicated in the good habitat, you actually know how it's going to fare 10 years from later. And we actually have data on how urbanization is happening. So we would be able to predict, using the current atlas itself, how it's going to do 10 years from now. Now if you can predict, can you reverse it? Can you do something to reverse it? Can you stop it by having some policies? Suppose you make the policies, can you measure it, whether it was successful or not? All these things can actually be measured by a particular. So this is the fundamental reason why mostly in the West, the bird atlas has been promoted, and that's actually a big thing out there. So these are some research on the bird atlas which have been published. This one, the British bird atlas, which ended in 2011. So they have the map of UK, and they are typically depicting two colors out here. So it, the key message here is that the breeding figures are mostly declining because you have the deep purple color mostly here. So they have a comparison with the previous settlers, and their results show that the breeding figures are actually declining. Next, please. So another view of it from the same atlas, they find that the common buzzards are increasing, so that's a good news. So that kind of change is something which the bird atlas will do. Next, please. Did we have bird atlas in India? Yes and no. So we had an atlas of birds in Delhi and Haryana. This, though it is a named bird atlas, is slightly different from the atlas which was done in the West. Here you have a set of records, and then using the records they created an atlas. So that's kind of the post analysis part of it. So you don't plan to do a survey and then analyze it. You collect all the records, show it in a map. It's quite useful, but it's slightly different from what is done in the West. And to some extent, this same strategy was also used in Manipal bird atlas, of course, in the Bangalore, Ravi brought up the book. He also showed his information in the form of maps. So these are the two things, attempts which has happened in India. Next, please. And the Mysore bird group, Shyamkumar Master and his set of friends, they did a 3-year Mysore atlas. And this, to a great extent, is similar to what was done in the West for bird atlas. So they made what they made sure is that they made sure that the entire area is crowded and systematically with equal effort. So you don't go to places where birds are there. You go to places which have been beautified by squires, and you go and do birding systematically in a particular season, twice a year, making sure that the effort you are putting in each of these places is the same. So this has been kind of a blueprint for us to develop on Kerala bird atlas. This is a much smaller scale, so Mysore is better. So it may be 400 square kilometers probably, and Kerala is close to 40,000 square kilometers. So that's the scale difference. But this is an attempt, probably the first in India, where a particular area has been systematically covered, and over a 3-year period of time, between 2 seasons, they have some better income. So I'm not going into details of it, that's a different topic altogether. But this is where it all started, so that we could actually make it into an other area. So what is Kerala bird atlas? So a few set of slides which are probably intense, but that will actually answer some of the questions which you have in mind. So this is an equal effort bird survey across the state. So we have the entire state to cover. And we have to make sure that wherever we are going, we have to do the same kind of effort in all the places. So it's an equal effort and systematic survey. Next, please. So what scale are we going to do? So what we decided is we need the scale at 6.6 by 6.6 square kilometers. So that is our cell. Why 6.6? So why not 10? Why not 100? So typically in India, 1 degree of latitude longitude is equal to 111 kilometers. 1 degree. So half a degree is 55, quarter degree is 26, 1/8 is 30, 1/16 is 6.6. So this is 1/16th of a degree by 1/16th of a degree. And why we try to align to a degree is because there are other data which is also available from land use pattern and climate and things like UN, which is also aligned to this degree. So whatever data we are going to generate, we should be able to superimpose on other data and do some more analysis. So that's the reason why we have actually chosen this unit as a factor of a degree. Next, please. Now this particular square is a huge area, and if you just ask birders to go there, they will just go and find some nice placed bird, do birding there and come back. That is not going to give you what actually would be. So we need a slightly smaller unit. So what we divided the 6.6 into 4 quadrants of each of 3.3 by 3.3. Still, that's a huge area which you can't cover for a state of Kerala. So next, please. We divided that again into 9. So each of these squares we call a subcell is about 1.1 square meter. 1.1 by 1.1. So that's what we got from the quadrants. Each quadrant has got 9 different subcells. Next, please. In that 9, we chose 1 randomly. So each quadrant has got a randomly selected 1x1 square kilometers, which has been chosen for green building. So that gives roughly about 10% of the state is covered. So we have close to 37,000 square kilometers, so that gives about 3,700 square kilometers of area we have to cover across different months in 5 years. That's the task. Next, please. So when do we do it? So in Kerala, we have only two seasons. We have a season of rains and we have a season of rains. There is no winter, we don't have any spring or anything like that. So just two seasons. We selected 60 days, 2 months in these two seasons, which is about 9 weekends. Weekends are important because most work gets done during the weekends. And we selected that, and then we said that, okay, these are the two windows in which you have to do the bird service. Next, please. Typically, we will ask a team to be 2 to 5 people and with 1 expert birder. So we may not get all 5 people as good birders. We will spread. There will be people who are beginners, there will be people who are just started. So it will be 2 to 5 people per team that we found as the most optimal size. Next, please. And we used eBird as the backbone, and I will tell you why we chose it. But if you already used eBird, there is a concept called as a complete list. A complete list is you are reporting all the species you saw, including crows and minus and spats. So whatever species you saw, you are going to report. That's called a complete list. 15 minutes, there will be 4 such complete lists taken by each team. So that is from each subset. So you have 4 lists over here. And similarly, 4 such subsets, you have 16 lists in every 6.6 by 6.6 level. And that's very two different seasons. So 32 lists, that's about 8 hours of birding in every 6.6 by 6.6 in Kerala, at most 3 seasons. So that's the effort which we have to expend to make sure that this address completes. So why eBird? We clocked about 1 million observations from Kerala last November. So quite a few of these peaks would also be contributed by Atlas, but the peak started somewhere here. So by the time we started Atlas, people have already adopted eBird, so there was already a distributed tool to which we can actually enter. Training has already been done, people are already using it. We just have to say that, go and do building, put in eBird, this is the protocol. So it saves a lot of extra effort in trying to create something new. You would have needed something new anyway for such a project. This is already there, so just embark on the same. So we were anyway going there, doing learning. So Suhail was first, so he said, why not do something additional? Anyway, you're going there. Try to get something which you cannot get by a satellite. So we thought that we probably can find out whether 4 invasive plants. This was decided after an online poll which are the species. So 4 invasive plants, if you see during your address, mark it. Yes, sir. So we had the 2 water plants and 2 open water land village ones. So we created a kind of a guide so that people who are going for the Atlas, they can actually say whether they saw it or not in each of the list. We have not compiled it, a lot of people have done it, some people could not do it, but we have not compiled it, but I think it would be interesting to see what we actually got out of this amazing place. Maybe 10 years, 20 years down the line, if you repeat it, some of this would have actually been spread out. So that's something else, sorry for that. Next, please. So this is typically an eBird list of an Atlas, what you have. So most of the parameters, if you are already used eBird, you know. But something important is that every district had a group account to which we shared the list, and the data was also downloaded from that particular list. And each subset has got a number, a triplet number, which actually uniquely identifies it. And some of the parameters like the different invasive species and some other information like fruiting feed, which Shishaji was also saying that figs are important for quantity. So for different birds, so we want to know whether there are any fruiting figs floating at that point in time. So this is typically how an eBird list will look like for any Kerala birds. Next, please. The large number of this actually there was central authority, like in British Atlas, there was BDO driving it. This was central authority driving it. A lot of organizations spread across, involved in it. Some people are actually deploying volunteers. Some people are supporting, for example, NCR is supporting. So Suhail and Abhinand has been helping us with protocol as well as generating the outputs. Some people are more at publicity, so Kood is a place where we try to use that medium as public for publicity. eBird is our database. So quite a big number of partners here. Next, please. And there are many, many virtual WhatsApp groups for acting. So we have a WhatsApp group for actors per district. And all of them are acting. So that's a kind of a decentralized, each district runs the show themselves. And we compile it back. And we have an annual gathering of the coordinators. So we meet annually in June in Trishu. So this is the last day we meet. So close to 1,000 brothers, I would say, are involved here, because every group where they're acting is like between 60 to 100, and we have 40 districts. So around 1,000 people have till now participated. So it's kind of huge, and it's easy to be led to decentralize that everything is centrally managed. But trying to make sure that it's managed in a way so that everybody does the same thing and actually can compile together into one common format. Next, please. So this is where we are currently. We are exactly the midday. We have completed 2 years of complete atlas for both season, and the wet season for this year is over. So after the wet season atlas, which ended in September 15, 78% of Kerala is covered. So most of the smaller districts are more or less done. This is the height of the bar indicates the size of the district. And this means not done, this is done. So these are all kind of done. We have a bit to cover here. Most of them are forests or mountains. The villages and imposts have been completely covered in most of the districts. So this is kind of the status which we have. So we give this to the coordinators also, they get a feel of this, what is pending. For dry season, we would be roughly at 50%, but we will reach this number by March. Next, please. Some of the results of the first year. So last June, we released 2 district atlas. So these are the 2 districts which actually started first. We wanted to see whether how it goes in 2 districts. They were able to complete more or less. So they came up with a booklet in this format. So we have the kites here, one picture of each kite. And then the wet season and the dry season maps. As you can see, the Brahmicate seems to be more common. This is the Alapia atlas. The Brahmicate seems to be much more common than the black kite. And apparently in dry season, there seems to be a little more higher density of Brahmicate than the wet season. And this is the seasonality chart, which we have developed. So these 2 atlases were released with a lot of fanfare. So that is the Honorable Minister for Agriculture, Agriculture's Sunil Kumar releasing the 2 atlases in issue. A lot of media traction, because the moment minister comes, media comes. The more media publicity, we get more dollars for this season. So, That's the kind of results, and the next atlas is due this year. Karnur is going to release it next month in October during the wildlife exhibition. Next, please. So some results which are there, so these are all available in this website. So you should be able to see it all on the website. This was again developed by Abhinams from NCF, so another Bangalore degree. So we would have some gaps here, because those data has come this year, we haven't taken. So white chick poppy is clearly our most common species. It's there in most villages, it's there at the cost, it is there in the hills. So dry season seems to have a little more higher detection, probably because they're calling more during the dry season. Wet season they may not be calling that much. But that's clearly our most common species. Next, please. Asian coil, another interesting species which seems to have much more abundance in the dry season. That's partly or probably mostly because they are calling during March, while in the wet season they are not calling. We had some other monitoring program which was running, and there also the pattern is clear that during GPBC, Asian coil is the third most common species in Kerala, entire Kerala, and during the wet season where we do autumn bird count, it's not even in the top. So that is reflected also in the atlas all across Kerala. Next, please. Golden oriole is clearly a migrant. It's not seen in the wet season from June to September. It's there across Kerala, not very common, but reasonably in most of the villages. So that pattern is coming out here. Next, please. This is a reverse pattern for lesser whistling duck. Lesser whistling duck used to be still one of the largest congregating bird in winter in most of the wetlands. So there was a hypothesis, where are they going during wet season? We don't see duck numbers or wetlands during the wet season. So their hypothesis was that they are all spreading into the paddies. They are going to the villages in ones and twos and breeding them. And that actually came out very well. when we did the map, the essence in that clearly is everywhere in the villages during wet season. When it rains, the paddy fields are full, and twos and fours, there will be residents in most of the paddy fields. And in dry season, an atlas like a randomized effort like this, so many other atlas. So you would probably not have go to places where there are a lot of birds. So some places where the we covered wetlands, this index are there. But largely absent the villages, but during the wet season, it's there in most of the villages. So these patterns which we are either not aware or we had a hint that it may be the case, came out clearly with the data of atlas over the last 2 years. Next, please. This is another case, jungle and yellow billed barren. If you have birded, you will kind of know that there is some amount of habitat preferences, yellow billed preferring a drier habitat, while jungle barren preferring a more wooded habitat. And this is not a maps and field guides are showing. There is no information on this, where it's found, where it's not found. But when you did that, it's clearly there are parts where jungle is more common, where yellow billed is absent. So yellow billed is here, anthem is here. But interestingly, now Kerala both are found. So what exactly is so special about those substances where both are found together? Why other substances one is more dominant? We don't know yet, but this might become even more obvious when we get the missing districts covered this year. So these kind of fine scale distribution pattern, which was not available here earlier, is getting here. And what happens after 10 years, this place becomes like this, whether the entire jungle urban will disappear and we get replaced by urban urban. That's a kind of prediction which we also have been looking at the subset with other parameters. Next, please. So that's more about the results. The website which I mentioned, you will have all the data. You should be able to get all this kind of maps and all the birds. This is about how this is managed. So because this is a kind of a large project that we need people to be independent and able to find information on themselves, this is our dashboard. So this is also developed in Bangalore by Fauzi and Vijay. And it shows all the different districts and where the subcells are and different color shades, indicating whether the subcell has been covered or one list or two lists has been created. So there are different gray shapes for each number, each list you are adding. And if the lists are reviewed by the coordinator, it turns purple. So the target is to turn all the subsets to purple, but this is a very, it's real-time status of which are the lists which are completed and what's the status. And that's available to our institute. People can actually see it online through mobile or website. Next, please. So this is another view of the dashboard where you can zoom in. So these lines are what are called as a cluster. So a logical group of subcells is called a cluster. For example, in Bangalore, we can say Whitefield cluster, Indiranagar cluster. So you would actually see what cluster it is, what sites are there, where are the lists which are there. And you can also download this as a KML file and use it in data computing. Next, please. So you can also see the number of the subcells here. So this is the way in which people are able to identify where the gaps are and what they need to do to fill it. Next, please. So where is the subset? That's the next question. Okay, you have identified the subset, you have a map. Now I am going to the field and how do I know that I am inside the subset or not? So before the atlas, we tried what is called the prototype atlas in one district, few subsets. So for the coordinator, this is what he did. He looked at the map, he wrote it down saying that you have to get down this top, from there you have to walk 100 meters, you will see a cross, take a left and go to the wall, and from there you will see a small path. That's what he's describing here. And he did that for all the subsets and took a WhatsApp image and sent to coordinators. It was mad. He would be in the field, somebody will call saying that that cross is not there, should be taken left or right. He would be in another subset doing something. So he didn't scale, he said that this is not going to work, we need something else. So the assignment fell onto somebody else. Next, please. To find an app. So George said he's the one who found this assignment. He found an app where he can load the table files and without having data connection, like Google Maps data connection. Without having data connection, with just a satellite connection, you should be able to see it. So that was it, and we found this locust tree map. People downloaded it, and I think the locust tree people would be surprised the number of downloads which came from one property. GPS viewer was for the Windows phones, for the Android phones. And this is, the basics are very simple, but it's a complicated app. It can also do track records so that next time dry season when you are going, you can use that track and you don't have to do the entire thing. It was complicated, but it was surprising how people took it. They just jump started on it. There was a document which he created which had all the steps through it, and people looked at the document and they were all able to manage themselves. There are not too many questions. They were using this app for many other things, not just for attacks. So I was surprised that we thought this would be the biggest problem, but it went quite smoothly. People took it and people are using it now. But now the net connection is quite good, so you can manage Google Maps also. You probably don't need office space in different app. So mountains are a different thing altogether. So when you see a locus and you are just walking and seeing, okay, you reach a subset, you will see a big mountain to climb. No path or river which you cannot cross. So this requires something more. So we have needed some amount of GIS effort to map and see the route, how you want to come for the Google Maps. These two are also done by George. He helped a lot in creating these kind of maps which can be used by people who are actually in the field. In the field, when it rains, these kind of details are very important, otherwise you will get lost very easily. And forest department staff would not know these subsets, they know only places. So we have to tell them, say, from here you want to start, go like the direction, navigate and reach that particular subset. So this was done for mostly for forest mountains where accessibility was an issue. So a lot of information which is there, we needed one place to store all the information. So Suhail gave us a place to store. This is our home page. If you Google Kerala Wildlife, this is the first hit. It has got all the information which is required. It has got the dashboard, it has got the results of the map, all media publicity which has come, links are available. It has got the list of coordinators, it has got the share ID of people, all the ID guides for invasives and locus map, and it has also the protocol which we described. So all information in one place so that people can do most of the things of themselves. And if they need, they can of course go back to the coordinators. And this is also a reference for the coordinators so that they don't forget things. There are people who might forget the dates, when it ends and all, but all information is centrally located and they can actually use it themselves. So this is quite useful having it so that we don't have to individual level help. Next, please. We do have a Facebook page. This is not used for data collection. It is more of information dispersal of where we are, what are the maps, and how we are doing. So that was a more of an activity on Facebook page. Next, please. So when we started it, we have to report how different districts are doing. So we started doing these kind of charts. Every Thursday for the 60-week period, this is the target line, we published where how the different districts are doing. So happened that people started taking it seriously. It became kind of a game. So every Thursday people would actually be challenging each other, saying, okay, now this week, why not we beat Kannur? So this became kind of a game that is no longer just scientific, but they have a team spirit. They are trying to coordinate and make sure that they are covering much more than what is expected. And typically any kind of project will start slow and everybody is speaking towards them. That's what is happening. Last week there will be a dash. People will take leaves and go out all around the district, go to far off places. So that gamification, though it was not intentional, it actually helped because towards the last, people actually give that extra spirit just for the district, for the some kind of an ownership to complete it comes through this kind of a chart. So now this has become kind of a de facto, everybody expects this chart to come out on Thursday, Friday they plan, Saturday, Sunday they out. Media has been helping us quite a lot. So all districts have got media reports. This is which came into where even the maps were given. And that actually helps because this is more of a people's event. So we need more people to come into it. So the moment they see media reports, more people come into it. So this is done by Adira, who works for Hindu. She is an NCBS alumni. So her Bangalore connection. A lot of things happened for Kerala voters from Bangalore. So,
half the Kerala is in Bangalore only.
Yeah. So this is done right now. So she's done a great job. So this actually gives a lot of people get in. Next, please. We also need celebrities into it because that's when more people, media will come with celebrities. Media will bring more voters and more celebrities. So this is some Kannur actress inauguration. A lot of celebrities here. Like this is a collector who's trying to buy a place for the first day. And this is right on Gorakhpur's inauguration, the early bird booklet from NCF translated to Malayalam is released by Sri Aditya Varma and Rashmi Varma, the royal prince and princess. this is in front of the palace. Incidentally, one of the subcell fell in the palace. So after the inauguration, they all went inside the palace, built the subcell. Lot of fanfare, videos are taken, they did the publicity. Lot of people came there. So bringing these kind of people for people's event really helps. Next, please. So it's not just in Malayalam and Malayalam or English, it also came in Kannada. This Kannada Kasaragod edition. This year they tried and a lot of support from Forest Department and the fantastic young team out there. And Kasaragod village is full of Western villages. It's a very low density district in Kerala, and Malabar province, Greater Kerala, like every other subset has got this. So they completed the atlas also this time, and next year they will be out with the book. So I'm really looking forward to that address, because that's probably the old Kerala when population density was not that high. So that was how it was all down here. Just having Kasaragod district, which is having a difference, quite different from the rest of the districts due to the density population. And this orange bush green pigeon, I think probably the only site in Kerala where you can definitely see orange bush green pigeon are in Kasaragod. Next, please. That's the last slide. So this has become kind of a celebration that people go out, do the subset, take a selfie and come back. And this is not a part of the plan. People started doing it, a lot of young people out there, they love it. They are doing it as if it's the job to do it. And this is from the Kannur Bharatiya Street. They created a collage out of it. And they have the atlas coming out next month. So this is the typical case in most places that a lot of people are doing it as a celebration rather than it is a part of scientific activity, there is a protocol to follow, but it's more about doing something for a district team spirit, cooperating and making sure that your district is right on top like any other district, and making sure that they are not left behind. So now all the districts have started and they are all full-fledged, they have 2.5 years to grow. People from Karnataka, Mysore participated a lot in Wayanad and even to people who bring it. So you are welcome to join this Restart Channel 15, and then there are 2 more years to go. So feel free to join this particular endeavor which is happening in Kerala. Be a part of it, it's a celebration. Join us and let's all celebrate to next please. That's it. I can't thank one particular person, it's a huge number of people who are behind it, and images are from the birth of the world.
There are 5 more slides.
Backup slides, if you have some questions, I can show it to you. It's probably the same thing. We haven't gone to the sea with Atlas yet. There is an ambition to do that, but it's not a part of this 5-year plan which you have thought. Because that is going to be a lot more resources than what we currently have. Because here mostly it's run by students, and there are a lot of people who are retired and saying that I have time, I don't know the words, I'm ready to compute. So such people are there, but the pedagogy requires a little more funding in terms of water and all this. There is an ambition, we don't know whether it will happen or not, let's do the land first.
Admirable efforts.
Thank you.
Overall, how many man hours have gone in?
So that's it now. So eight hours in each subcell. And we are talking about 4,000 subcells. So 8 hours, 1 year. So 4,000 days. 78% of vaccines is done. So it comes to around 1,500 to 2,000 has been done now.
Hope you are not doing a mental accounting with that.
So that's what the scope itself, when we define it, we said that we would be able to get this at least good for a lot of common, easily predictable species. We may not be able to get for tricky species, we may not be able to get for cryptic species or the secretive species, and we may not be able to get for wilderness. So we probably are going to get 50 to 60% of the birds in good data. 40% of the birds which are found in Kerala, we may not be able to get with this kind of information. But that's the majority of it which can actually predict the change here. The rest of the guys may not. So, for example, green greenish problem, we put as one entry. We don't separate them. Green slash greenish problem is one entry. Even if people separate them, we combine them, then you create them. We don't trust that identification.
The subcell you choose is random breakdown out of that.
Yes.
Do you select couple of subsets or you select only one subset?
In a 3x3 quadrant, we select one.
Only one?
Only one.
So there is some chance of error with what you discussed just
now. It's random. So, we randomize so that we don't let birdwatchers choose. Otherwise, they will go to the favorite birds.
Okay.
We want them to go to good places and bad places. We don't
give. So, it's randomly you give or?
We give. Randomly we give. So it's predefined before that
system. Two questions. One is, what is the kind of effort involved
in the data crunching, the
mapping, and all that?
Like, so,
you spoke about predictions. So, what are you doing as in how are you doing it and
what is? Okay. So, we haven't started predictions. We'll come to the data crunching part of it. Currently, whatever maps chasing is basically converting the data which is there in the word into maps. So there Abhinand has written a script which is posted there, which actually takes the map of Kerala and the subsets and the lists, downloads eBird data and populates it. So that's a program which has been done, which we are using. So I don't know how much Abhinand took for writing, probably a week, I don't know. And the second part we haven't started, but we hope to compare this data with the land use pattern information which is already available, and the population density and these kind of things, and then try to say what will happen after 10 years, basically. So that's our idea. We are still halfway. We probably will start looking at it more closely next year. So this year, if we complete around 80%, we have the test data to start doing those kind of analysis. So next year, when we are collecting the data itself, we can see whether it's coming out properly or we need to redo some subsets. So last year is for those kind of error corrections after seeing the results of those analysis. We haven't started that. Probably we'll start next year.
So during this survey, the stage has realized it is easy. Do you think you can extend this project to some other states? What I'm saying is,
put a multiplier, yeah? Why not? Just put a multiplier, no?
I don't know. I think Subbu had a plan to discuss, can we do something for Bangalore? You'll see Supreme. Probably. Bangalore is quite achievable, is what I personally think. But going towards North Karnataka or the northeast Karnataka, that's where the bird density is very less. Looking at the eBird map system. So it's replicable to many places in Karnataka, but as an entire state, it would be quite a big effort. But you don't know, when we started, we didn't know whether we'll do it. We had a feeling that, okay, let's start, let's see how it comes. Where we are standing, it looks like we are on schedule, we should be able to complete in 5 years. But the moment you start, you know what. There may be things which we don't know. There are strengths which we don't know. It should be there. It's my purpose.
Can someone
check
this that are created, not intended as part of the satellite?
Yes, so you saw that seasonality chart which is there. Right? So that is actually completely a part of the rest of the effort. And we still haven't figured out how to use those checklists along with Atlas. So Atlas, we have a golden data, really very systematic data. Can you use it by using the rest of the checklist by extrapolation or something like that? We may be able to, we haven't tried. It's maybe possible. So if there are experts out here who can help us, please, we would need them next 2 weeks.
Sir, don't you think this kind of data helps poachers to find the species?
Yeah, we had got that question earlier. What we at least find is that poachers already know. If they were part of our expedition, we would have actually heard. They already know it. And the other thing is that the number of species which are threatened by poaching in Kerala are less. Species wise. Of course, there are wetlands where everything is hunted. So these kind of maps are not going to, this is giving a species specific map. That's not going to help poaching in that way. You go to wetland birds and just trap everything that is coming. Specific species, specific threats in Kerala for poaching, as far as we know, are much less. And if it is there, they already know where to go.
One is when you are collecting the data, counting the number of birds. Second thing which I want to add to your discussion is that most countries, before they image the bird radars, but even after the invention of bird radars, also from airports, this data is very important. And when we go to the prediction part maybe next year, I think this will be helping most of the Indian airports also for predicting the or maybe coordinating the bus tracks with
Got it. So basically trying to see the same habitat occurs elsewhere and see what species are there. We will connect.
Do you survey the night birds?
No. So we did survey the night birds because that is again too much of a effort which was involved. So that would definitely be underrepresented in the natural scale network. However, when we did forest when we are actually camping here, we made it mandatory for the camps, people who are staying in the camp, to do 4 nocturnal lists from each of the forest area. This was wet season, it was raining, it has not been successful. So we have seen dry season in how we come. But wet season, rains and nocturnal birds and nocturnal list really important. And this was a very, very wet season this time.
The season continues.
Behind the other birds at last. Wish you all the best, and on behalf of the birds, thank you.